is actually working. Something? Can you hear me? Yeah.
Okay. So we have now Katherine Heitman talking about how to simulate the universe. This is her second talk of three.
Yeah. I'm glad this is not like an American TV show that you can vote out the speakers as they didn't do a good job in the first part of the lecture, so I'm still here. So as you can see, I switched the topic, so I will talk today about cosmic emulators, and on Friday I will do something about this. And so the first three talks in the morning were very, very nice, and a lot of data were shown. And so in this talk we are going back to theory land. So I think there's one plot in the next hour that has some data, but overall this is more theory heavy. I'm going to tell you a little bit of a story which started in 2006, and it occurred to me today, this is a decade ago, so I feel really old now. So this is a project that we did with collaborators from the statistics field. So here's Dave Higdon and Brian Williams and Derek Bingham and Earl Lawrence. So these guys are all statisticians. It's very interesting if you work with these guys because you have to explain to them the physics, they have to explain to you the math. And it's very rewarding if it all turns out right. And at the start, we wrote a couple of papers where we basically had a proof of concept of what I'm going to present to you today. Then we really put it in action, and now down here we have kind of a small industry on building these so-called emulators. And why is it fun to work with statisticians? Because they are really different than physicists and a fun crowd. And so just to show you this, right? I mean, they're riding dinosaurs, right? This is Earl Lawrence, and this is his official Los Alamos picture. Like, Los Alamos, you can type in ask an expert, and if you type in statistics, you get Earl, and you get this picture. So it's, he's really a great guy. And he actually made this emulator photograph also. So yesterday, we talked about large-scale structure simulations, and this morning, we heard this very nice talk by Will talking about the power spectrum, so I'm really, really glad that he introduced this for me. So what you see up here is actually the large-scale structure distribution, just the dark matter, for three different models. So what we did here was we took the same initial phases, we simulated a lambda CDM model, a model with no dark energy, and a model with warm dark energy, and you can see the structures are quite different, and that's what we want to tease out of the data. And so what you can do is you can measure, for example, the power spectrum. Here you have seen this now several times. Today is the linear power spectrum. Both of these are at V of zero in this purple color, and the nonlinear power spectrum in green here. And there's a lot of information down here in this part where the nonlinearity comes in. And the information you can get out of this is you can distinguish modified gravity theories from dark energy models. You can explore neutrinos, you can explore properties of the dark matter, like, for example, here you see the warm dark matter. If you would plot up, and I overdid this, this is totally ruled out, just to show you how the structure is smooth out. But if you plot the power spectrum for this, it's much more suppressed than if you would plot the power spectrum for this. So getting the power spectrum prediction on these small scales here, very accurate, is very important and will lead us to new physics that we can extract from the observations. So how do we do that? What we do in cosmology is we extract cosmological constraints from observations by running Markov chain Monte Carlo codes. You have seen in the previous talk, you have seen lots of ellipses, and so what you do is you run thousands, 10,000, 100,000 of different models against the data and you get constraints out of that. So in the CMB world, we have been really, really successful with this. We used CAM mostly, or variations of CAM, to do this. And so we want to do exactly the same also for the nonlinear power spectrum, for example, in the nonlinear regime. So now we have a problem here. So if we have to run 10,000 or 100,000 models, so hack I showed you yesterday, it works really great. And you might remember it's kind of a race car, but it still doesn't run in like seconds. So it still takes 24 hours to do a simulation. So if I would want to analyze data from a nonlinear power spectrum and run a simulation for each model I'm interested in, and suppose I would have a cluster which has 1,000 nodes, and I have it all for myself, so I can run it 24/7. It would take me 30 years to do this analysis. So this is clearly not practical. So the current strategy that we are following is we are trying to come up with fitting functions for the nonlinear power spectrum. So you have heard of HaloFit, for example, where you try and come up with some physics arguments how the nonlinear behavior of the power spectrum should look like. You take a simulation and you tune some parameters to make it really match, and you get a fitting function to the power spectrum. The problem is that if you change the cosmology, first of all, you would need another simulation to make sure that your prediction was actually accurate, so this doesn't work all that well. And the other problem is that if you vary cosmologies beyond lambda CDM, with HaloFit, for example, you get an error of a few percent. And the upcoming surveys like LSST and DESI, they want to measure things like the neutrino mass, and variations in the power spectrum there are at the 1% level. So if you have a 10% prediction, you will get the wrong answer, so you can't use this. So in 2006, as I said, we started thinking about how can we solve this problem? How can we rely on just a relatively small number of very good simulations, very accurate simulations, to build something that is better than a fitting function and that allows us really to explore the parameter space very efficiently? And so we talked to the statisticians at Los Alamos, and we came up with this emulator concept. So they have had used that already for quite a while, and it really seemed the right way to go for us. And so the ingredients to this is that the first question I'm asking is, what simulations should I run? What models should I run? Then once I have done that, I take a look at a good representation of what the outcome of these simulations is. And once I have done that, I interpolate in between the outcomes with some clever schemes, and I can build these emulators. And I will walk you through this during this talk. And I will focus on the power spectrum. As I said, it was introduced very nicely in the morning. But you can do that basically with any statistics you can pull out of your simulation. You can do this for the mass function, for the galaxy power spectrum. I'm focusing on the meta power spectrum here. And basically, it's three steps. So first, you show that your simulation itself is actually accurate enough. And I talked about this a little bit yesterday. So you make sure that your box is big enough, you have enough particles in there, and so on and so forth. So I'm not going to talk about this today again. And then you really go and do what I said before. You see how many simulations do you need. You develop this interpolation scheme, and you go from there. You run the simulations, you build an emulator, and 10 years later, you stand here and you give a talk about it. So here is the whole, so we call this actually the cosmic calibration framework in 2006 and 2007, and here it's kind of in a schematic way. So what I was just talking about are these first three steps here. So the first step is you design the simulation campaign that you want to run, and you ask yourself, how many simulations can I run? And so a simulation these days, if you have a high-resolution simulation, it costs you maybe 2 million CPU hours on a fast cluster, and you can ask for maybe 100 million hours if you like. So you want to run something of the order of 10 to 100 simulations. Then you carry out the simulations, so that's here, and you extract what you want from the simulation. So in this case, it's the power spectrum. You choose a suitable interpolation scheme to interpolate between these. And so I'm talking a little bit about this. So in our case, this is Gaussian process modeling. Yesterday in the afternoon, in the late afternoon, somebody actually mentioned Gaussian processes already. And then you can build an emulator. At the same time, what you can do is you can actually put in data. And in our earlier papers, we did that. We simulated some data, and we showed how you do the whole thing with the MCMC chain down here, how you can see if your model is inadequate, how you put in more simulation. And so you can really take the observational input back into this whole system to have this whole framework. But today, I'm just going to focus on these blue boxes. So first step is the simulation design. So what you want to do is, so the first question you have to ask yourself, how many parameters do I want to simulate? And so in the Lambda CDM model, what we have is six vanilla parameters. So this is a good thing to start with. And so what you will see is that the number of parameters actually very much influences on how many models you have to simulate. So it's roughly the rule of thumb that the statisticians give you is 10 models per parameter. So if you want to go into a Lambda CDM model, 6 parameters, you need roughly 60 simulations. If you want to extend that, you need more. The other question that you have to ask yourself is, what does the parameter do to your power spectrum? So if you look, for example, at Omega Baryon, it almost does nothing to your power spectrum. It has a very, very small influence. But if you look at Sigma 8 or Omega Matter, it does much more. It changes the power spectrum quite a bit. So the second question you asked is, how many parameters do I actually have that do a lot to my power spectrum? And how many parameters do I have that don't do that much? When we did our first example, we actually reduced the number of cosmological parameters to 5 instead of 6. So we said that the Hubble parameter is actually so well constrained from CMB measurements that we don't explicitly have to simulate it. And this turned out to be, in the end, people were not very happy about this. But it was kind of an interesting discussion. I don't know, several of you know Martin White and have worked with him, and he's one of my favorite collaborators. And Salman Abib is also on this project, and both of them are very opinionated. And when I was saying, well, maybe we should put in the Hubble parameter, they were like, no, 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 that's stupid, because CMB gives us, once I have the other 5 parameters, CMB tells us what the Hubble parameter is, so nobody needs to vary this differently. But the community said afterwards, when we put this out, like, no, we want to be able to vary the Hubble parameter. But I just didn't want to argue with Martin and Salman, because it can be very, very painful. So now we have decided, okay, we do 5 cosmological parameters, and we also give them some range. And so the first idea that you could have is, when you set up your simulation suite, I just make a grid of simulations. So I say I take the smallest value of my parameter and the largest value of my parameter and the value in the middle. If you do that, you actually end up with 250 some simulations that you have to run. Given that they are expensive, you can't do that. Not a good idea. If you leave out the point in the middle, you get really poor coverage, so you don't want to do that. Second idea you can have is you do a random sampling. I just throw the points, and I see what I get. So this is good if you have, again, a lot of simulations that you can run, but what you'll see if you do this is that you actually end up with holes in your parameter filling. And so what we did was we used something called orthogonal array Latin hypercube. And you can do different things, but the main thing that I want you to take away from this is that you want something that fills up your parameter space. So here I actually only drew 3, because that's easy to do, and I projected them. So you can see here I vary parameter 2 and 3, and so what you see is that I'm kind of filling up, given that I only have 9 sample points here, I'm filling up this space quite nicely, quite evenly. And so this orthogonal array Latin hypercube design helps you with that. So it comes up with, first, you put everybody on this grid here, and then you start jiggling them around in this direction in such a way that if I project them down here in this direction, nobody overlaps. So you see, if I take all these blue points down here, they do not overlap. So that's kind of the idea. The other thing that you can do is, to make this even better, is you can calculate the distance between these points. And you want to make these distances evenly distributed so that they are roughly the same. And so there's a whole literature in the stats world in order to do this. And but the main point you should take away is that if I project this down into 2 dimensions, I want to have a good filling of the space. So as I said before, we do 5 parameters. So here are the 5 parameters. Omega Baryon, Omega Matter, the spectral index, the dark energy equation of state, and sigma 8. And I vary them with respect to the parameter constraints that we have already from surveys. And again, this question of how broad these priors are taken influences a lot of how many models you need. So you want to try to make this relatively small. Sometimes people come back and say, like, the weak lenses, for example, they were very unhappy that Omega M was not going all the way to 0 because they said we want to do weak lensing and we don't want to use CMB constraints, so we want to have this very broad range. But at that point, things become rather expensive, so we said, no, no, we can't do that. So what you see here is the design. So we created this design for these 5 parameters, And you see if I project them down in these two dimensions, they are quite nicely distributed. Now, just in order to show you what happens to the other parameters, so omega m you can obviously derive by just taking the little omegas and dividing them by h squared, right? And you see in that case, their distribution is actually not all that nice. And that's not surprising because we didn't optimize for these parameters. And one experiment that we did, because I was very curious about this, is with little h here, you see that, again, the design, it has big holes here, right? It doesn't cover this range, for example. So when it interacts with omega m, you don't get much coverage here. And we used these simulations, and we said, well, suppose h was free, and I didn't fix it to the CMB. What would happen? And you actually find that you don't get very good predictions from these emulators because you have these holes in here. So the design really, really matters. I mean, it, at first, might look like this is a minor thing, but it's really important. And as I said before, what you want to try is make the priors as tight as you can, as tight as the data allows you, and try to restrict your parameters. So in that case, you can get away with a restricted... Coming up. It's coming up. It's on this one. So what we did then was, so we asked this question, how many runs do we need? And we actually tried this out first with a linear power spectrum just to see, because that you can generate very, very quickly. And we started off with a set of 32, 64, 128 models. And we created a prediction scheme. And it turns out that 32 actually, with the setup that I just showed you, was sufficient. We ended up with 37 because there was some miscommunication between Martin and myself about how sigma 8 is defined in the simulation. That's also why the real Coyote universe goes down to 0.6, even though I told you on the slide before, we actually, oh, I said there 0.62. Originally, it was 0.7. So, but 32 models would have been sufficient, and in our paper, we actually, in the first paper that we wrote on this, we said 32, but in the end, it turned out to be 37. So now, the next step, you have these 37 models, you tested that your whole scheme will work well with this number, you start and run the simulations. And so here you see a plot of one of the models. So here you see delta squared that was introduced this morning by Will, and it's divided by k to the 3/2. And why is that? Because originally we thought that this gives you a little bit more of a handle on the baryonic wiggles here. So what you see here is when I run a simulation, I talked about this yesterday, you have to start with the realization of the universe, so you don't get a smooth answer from that. So this green line, let me start with the blue line. The blue line is actually a high resolution gadget run. So you see here the nonlinear power spectrum is very well captured. We plotted it here out to k of 2. But you see there's a lot of noise here because you have a finite volume, and its realization scatter because you only simulate one universe. So you have to do something about that, because when you build your prediction scheme, you don't want to build a prediction scheme for one realization, but you want to have something smooth. So then what we thought is, okay, we augment this with a bunch of particle mesh simulations. So we discussed yesterday they are much faster, so this is computationally not expensive. But we only push them out to an intermediate K range, somewhere here. So I plotted them all the way up to here, and here you see this effect that I was talking about yesterday, that the PM simulation actually lose power. So down here, the PM simulations are not reliable anymore, and the difference between the green and the red guy are actually different mesh sizes. So I explained yesterday like how you put the mesh onto the particle distribution, and if you pick your mesh smaller, then you even lose more power here. But since we said, okay, we only need this down here, and we don't care what it does here, this will work. So what your task now is that you take the average, so you have a very large number of these PM runs because they are cheap, and you match them to this blue line so that you get the nonlinear power spectrum out here reliably. The simulations that were run in this original setup were 1.3 gigaparsec boxes with a billion particles each. And with our formula yesterday, we know it's 10 to the 11 mass resolution. We printed out 11 outputs. between 0 and 3. And then here, these are the PM simulations, so 16 low resolution and 4 medium resolution ones. Actually, it turned out in the end that the medium resolution ones were not really necessary, but that's what we did. And so now let's talk about the smoothing question a little bit more. So you see here again the plot from the previous slide. And here are the baryonic wiggles. And you see it's a little bit hard to see them actually, right? So we need to smooth them out. And again, the statisticians, they're super smart people. They said what we can do is, and Dave Hickton had worked on this before in 2002, is we can make a moving average that smooths out the distributions here. And this moving average will actually, the width of this kernel will depend on how much structure there is. So down here where you are in the linear regime, there's almost no structure. Up here where you have the baryonic wiggles, there's a lot of structure. And so your smoothing window takes this into account. And if you do that, you actually, it's a little bit hard to see probably from the back, but in light gray there's still all this noisy stuff. And in blue is the smooth power spectrum. So you see now here you pulled out the baryonic wiggles here nicely. Here you have the smooth linear part, and here you have the nonlinear turnover in the power spectrum. And again, it looks a little funny because it was divided by k to the 3/2. So you do this now for 37 models. You produce a very smooth power spectrum for each of these models. And oh yeah, here's just a test of the smoothing procedure. So we wanted to make sure that this works. And again, you probably can't see this in the back, but there is this light gray, a lot of noisy stuff in the back, and you see this here as well. And so this red line here is the 1% error line. And so the blue is if I would just take the power spectra that I had and I take the average. And the red is what I get if I on top put this smoothing procedure. So I'm getting actually something that's quite close to the reality. And so here I divide by the linear power spectrum, so I know that exactly. So I know how good my estimate actually is. So now we are coming to the interpolation scheme. So after we have specified our simulation, our design, and we have carried out the simulations, now we have to interpolate. Remember, what we want to do is we want to have a prediction for the nonlinear power spectrum for any value set in this five-dimensional parameter space that I showed you at the start. And so this is now a little bit involved, and the details are not that important, but I'll walk you through this. So the first thing is, so here we have our power spectrum again, divided by k to the 3/2, and we take the logarithm of that. And what we want to do is we want to interpolate something that's a little bit easier. If you look at that, you have the k dependence here, so you have lots of k points. In the simulation, I store something like 1,000 points. And you also have a z direction. So we are also interested in predicting the power spectrum for different redshifts. So what you can do is, the first thing that you can do is you can take the mean power spectrum and just divide that out. So that gets rid of a lot of these fluctuations that you saw, right? And so that's actually done here. So what you see here is the power spectrum, the log of the power spectrum on this axis, the k value on that axis, and then here is the redshift evolution. And so what we have done here is we just took out the mean, and that's what you get. Then the next thing what you want to do is you want to come up with a representation that has lower dimensions. And what we do here is a PCA analysis. And just so I stole this from this web page down here. So here is kind of the concept of the principal component analysis. So what you're trying to do is you really are trying to extract strong patterns. And so if you go to this web page, this is actually an animation. So this is a three-dimensional distribution. And the way how they state this quite nicely is what you're looking at is the viewing angle of this three-dimensional distribution that allows you to project this down to get the first principal component that has the most variation. And so this is this guy here. So if you would just randomly project this down, you get distributions like that. But if you really do this smartly and you find the good angle, you actually pull out the most variation here in the first principal component. Then you do the second principal component, which has the second most variation, and so on and so forth. And at some point, hopefully, this will die down, and there's nothing left over. So in our case, so this is just a conceptual explanation. So So obviously, there's a rigorous mathematical way of how you do that. And so in our case, what we had to do was we created a matrix from our power spectra. So remember, we had the power spectra on a grid that covers K as well as a redshift. And M is here the number of models that we had. So we took this matrix, and we carried out a singular value decomposition, and we calculated the principal components. And just going back to that, this is what you get. And then you can go on and see how many of these components you need to keep. And it turns out, so you can kind of see this, it's a little hard to see, but here at the basis 5, you're almost flat, there's almost nothing left here. So you do that with your power spectrum. So you decompose it in this way. And at the same time, you then get these weights here that multiply your basis function. And it's these weights that it turns out it's easy to interpolate. So this is, again, the statisticians had done this all before, so that was really, really nice, because if you would have started from here and tried to interpolate the power spectrum itself, it would have been very painful because you just have a lot of information here. So now you start and do this interpolation, and you use Gaussian processes for that. And let's look at Gaussian processes. As I said, somebody mentioned this yesterday already. And so the Gaussian process modeling approach is always very nice if you want to do something where you want to do a regression, but you don't want to want it to be parametric. So it's a non-parametric regression scheme, and it's really well suited for something if you want to do an interpolation between smooth functions. So the power spectrum lends itself for this quite nicely, or the PC component, the weights of the PC components that we just looked at. And what you do is you take a Gaussian distribution and you basically extend it into function space. And again, so what we see here is kind of a cartoonish picture of what you want to do. So you throw realizations here, so these are from a Gaussian random distribution, and you just put in lots of functions here. And then you say you have two measurement points. So the measurement points in our case are the exact power spectra that we have. So you have 37 of these. And you lay down these power spectra. Now what you want to do is you want to force all of these random realizations to go through your measurement points. And here we also give it a little bit of a variance here. We don't know this measurement point very exactly, but you can also say you know it exactly. And then you take the average of this, and you see you get the conditional mean. And so down here, this picture is shown again. So here is actually an explicit correlation function that you want to create from this. And what you want to optimize is this value L here. So this correlation function can be also picked differently. So this is just one example of that. And so what you see here in this picture is, unfortunately, again, probably from the back, you don't see this very well. But so the black guys here are your measurement points again. And then you try to optimize for this correlation length. So you throw a lot of these realizations, and you optimize for this L. So in this case of the red curve, the procedure actually didn't work all that well because the L was constrained too small. So what you ending up is you go through each and every measurement point exactly. So you don't want to do that because that's obviously not the right curve that fits these measurement points. The other extreme is that your L comes out much too big, so you smooth out everything. That's the blue point. You don't want to do that either. So you have to be careful, and when you optimize for this L, and so in this case, the green curve here is kind of the optimal thing. And again, you do this with an MCMC chain. So this is basically the concept that you're using. You're trying to optimize this correlation length here. They're called hyperparameters in the statistics world, in order to get a really good interpolation between these measurement points. And now, instead of just having these points, we have for each model, we have a power spectrum. So all of this goes just into higher dimensions. I can't draw it easily on the board anymore. But this is the concept behind it. So you put this all together, and you smooth through these, and you get an emulator. And so now here you see somebody is running the emulator. He puts in omega M, omega baryon, NF, sigma 8, W, ask what output do you want, key or delta, and it's done. So it's even faster than CAM. So it's really, really instantaneous. Here you see, I also told them then to please do a new plot of this, and so you see here's the result for the nonlinear power spectrum at Z of 0 and Z of 1. So here we have the emulator again. So what we have done in these first couple of projects was we started out, we wanted to get an accurate prediction for the power spectrum at redshifts between 0 and 1 out to a modest k value of 1 at 1% accuracy. And so what you can see here is this is actually an example. So we simulated another model that we didn't use to build this emulator, and we took a look at how well our emulator does. So this is the ratio of the emulator over the simulation, and this is the 1% error line. And you see we are actually, and these different lines are different redshifts, so we are doing really pretty well. So then the next question was, as I said before, people were complaining that we didn't include H as a free parameter, and they also wanted us to go out to higher K, beyond K of 1. So we thought, what can we do in order to achieve this without having to completely redo this project? We didn't want to rerun a lot of high resolution simulations because they are costly. So we came up something which Earl then calls a Franken-EMU, and again, Earl is responsible for this picture. And what we did was we said, well, we don't want to run a large number of very big simulations, but maybe we can augment the simulations that we have with smaller boxes. So what you see here is actually a set of boxes. So these are different volumes that we simulated in order to get out to higher K values as well as higher redshifts. And what you see is that, so this is a log-log plot, right? And you see that these overlaps are not perfect, right? You really see in this nonlinear turnover regime that the small boxes are suppressed, and this is really a numerical issue because you don't capture the linear modes in the box correctly, so you don't go out all the way here. And so the emulator that will come out of this is not as accurate, just because the simulations are not as accurate. And when you start now the smoothing procedure that I told you before about, you have to be really careful because actually these amplitudes don't match all that well anymore. So it's really a Franken-EMU. It's not a clean emulator that comes out of this. So what we did was we moved slightly the amplitude up and down to make this all match smoothly. We said that the amplitude from the very large boxes should be the most accurate. And so you come up with something like that, and here you see how we match them all together. On a log-log plot, it looks good, but if I would show you the ratios, it's okay, but not perfect. Sorry? Renormalized perturbation theory. So, yes. But you can also take any other second order perturbation theory. So we made sure that on these scales, right, because you don't even have to smooth, right? I mean, perturbation theory, higher order perturbation theory is good, right? Yeah. And yeah, as I said, I mean, we tried it out with second order perturbation theory, it's as good. Because we really, really cut this off at very large scales. So you do the whole game over again, you smooth them, you create these power spectra. So now, as you can see, we are going out here to K of 10. And we also increase the redshift range to Z of 4. And you see our error bars just get bigger, because this was all not really, really perfect. But still, we have error bars at roughly the 2% level, which is still better than 10% or 5% from Hilleflick. So it's still pretty, pretty good. Then the extension for the Hubble parameter was a little bit more tricky, and you see it worked even less well. And what we did here was we said we can create a linear power spectrum for as many Hubble parameters as we want. So I ran like 100 linear power spectra, and then what we did was we said, okay, we can create an emulator out to here, which is very, very accurate, which has the Hubble parameter included. But then from here on onwards, we only have the information from the Hubble parameter from these 37 models that we have, because we know what the value is. It's just not perfectly distributed. And so we matched these things together. Again, the statisticians were very smart doing this. And you get something, but it's not perfect. So you can download these emulators, actually. So that's a nice thing. And you can do many, many more things. So Juliana Kwan was a postdoc with us. She said, well, it would be also nice if not only do I look at the metapower spectrum, but also at the galaxy power spectrum. So what she did was she took one of the high-resolution simulations, actually higher resolution than what I presented before, and she used a halo excitation distribution model in order to put galaxies into that. And I don't want to go into many details, but basically it gives you an idea. You measure the mass of the halo, and it tells you what kind of galaxies is in the halo. And here are the central galaxies, the satellite galaxies, and you see the HOD has parameters that you are actually tuning against observations. And so what Juliana did was she took the simulation output and she generated 100 galaxy power spectra with these varying these parameters, again, following exactly the same idea, creating a design, generating the power spectra, the galaxy power spectra in correlation functions in this case. And so now you have an emulator that actually gives you the galaxy power spectrum. And here's the result. And so this is, as I said, there's only one plot with data and it doesn't even have error bars, so I apologize for that. But here's an emulator result, and we didn't subtract shot noise, which we should have here. And this is a very early picture from these results. But you can see that these two lines, the green and the blue line, are actually the same cosmology, but different HOD models implemented. So now you can start playing around and see what happens to your galaxy power spectrum if you do that. And this is a comparison to the halo model, but I don't want to go into details about that. Another thing that Juliana did was she looked at the concentration mass relation. So in the previous talk, we heard about the halo profiles, and one parameter that characterizes the halo profile as the so-called concentration. So you can measure that again from all these simulations very nicely, and you can start and building a concentration mass relation emulator that again goes through different cosmologies. And here you see how well that does. So here these points are actually from the original simulation. The blue line is the prediction from the emulator. And the dotted line is just the best fit power loss through these measurement points. And again, you can go to our webpage, you can download this, and so you can play around and measure the concentration mass relation for different cosmologies at pretty high accuracy. So in the last, how much time do I have left? 20 minutes or so. I'm going to talk to you about the next step. That's what I told you. At the first, we had like a proof of concept. Then we implemented it and showed it actually works, and now it's an industry, so we are continuing to work on it. And so I really want that the emu gets happy again. I want to predict a power spectrum that really doesn't suffer from the shortcomings that I talked about before. And so for that, we created the Mira-Titan universe. And so you might ask, where do these weird names come from? I actually got, when we put out the Coyote Universe papers, I got an email from a journalist asking if this is a new cosmological model. But it's not. It's really just the machine, the supercomputer, where the simulations are run on. So what do we do with this next step? So one thing is that we extend the parameters that we are using for the simulation suite. So now we have H is now really, really free. And we also have WA and massive neutrinos in the simulations. So we have a dynamical dark energy parameterized in a way that Eric showed yesterday. And we have massive neutrinos. And one worry that I had was that running now simulations for all these and getting the power spectrum accurately at K of 10 will be very, very expensive and it will take a long time. So is there something that we can do that is more like a nested design? I run the first set of simulations, I build an emulator, which might not be perfect, but pretty good, and then I go on and simulate more simulations and generate more simulations, and then improve my emulator over time. And so this is when Derek Bingham, a statistician from Simon Fraser University from Canada, came in, and he came up with a very nice method. And I don't have time to go into detail into this method, but the anecdote about this is that we had this small little stats cosmology workshop, and the statisticians always like challenges. So they asked me in the morning, so I said, like, this is my problem. I don't want to run 100 simulations, and it takes me 2 years, and I don't have any outputs in between. Is there anything that we can do better with these designs? And they got very excited and said, yes, we can do that. Can you give us, they said, we give you our best idea of how you would set up these nested designs, and you simulate them. Again, we took the linear power spectrum because that's fast, and we see which of the statisticians does best. And they were all very confident that they can do this really well. It turned out so three or four people tried this out, and three of them miserably failed. The predictions for the very small number of simulations were really, really bad. And so Derek won the competition, and he was the person who was included in the paper. So what you see here is actually, so I told you I have now 8 parameters, and I still want to do only a very small number of simulations. And what you see here is actually the prediction of the power spectrum for only 26 models. And so here this dashed line is again the 1% line. And overall, we are actually doing quite well. So when I show you this plot, is what I'm doing is I have the 26 models. We build the emulator from that, and then we run another 10 models, totally different models within the boundaries of my parameters, and we see how well does the emulator do. And so you see here, so here's the 5% mark. And given that I have 8 parameters and 26 models, this is actually pretty good. And these outliers here are actually extreme cases of W0 plus WA being really close to zero. So I'm not so worried about that. So now I add another 20-some models to this, so I add up to 55. And so you see now we are actually in the bound of 5% with almost all of them. So this is really nice. And then I add yet another 50 models. I don't know why this is. And then I'm back to almost my 1% limit. So this works actually really, really well. And so what this enables me to do is to actually give you guys a prediction scheme really early on. And the other thing that we are gearing up to do is, so Juliana is involved again. Is Bhuvnesh still here? Yeah, so she's taking her evening hours, because Juliana is working with Bhuvnesh very hard on DES, but she's taking her evening hours to also work on some emulators. And so she has actually put in RSD redshift-based distortion predictions, so they are measured from all these simulations now as well. So she's working on that. She's also looking into extending the galaxy power spectrum and correlation predictions to include cosmology dependence. What I showed you before was all built on one cosmology and just varying the 5 parameters in the HOD model, but so now she's working on including this all. So Bhuvnesh, don't give her a hard time. She's doing a really good job with that. So this is just, right. And then we were also asking if we do the same for the mass function. And so what I did here is I just assumed universality. So it's kind of an approximate way of getting a mass function for different cosmologies. And so you see that, again, this dashed line here is the 1% limit. So we can also build very nice predictions for the mass function. In the back, yep. Yeah, I know. So this is, the mass function goes out to 10 to the 15. That's here. And so this is the 1% error level. And up here it's 15%, but we don't go there. So this guy is, it's a 5% error. And on the left here you see actually the result. This is again this question about the smooth power spectrum. So here you see that I matched together. So now this time I used TimeRG just to do something different. 16 particle mesh simulations and high resolution run, which actually this didn't come out all that well, but it's 30 to 100 cube particles in a 2 gigaparsec box. So these are the standard high resolution runs that we are doing now. And here you see if I take the ratio of the original simulation to the smooth power spectrum that we generate, it's, there's no bias of any kind. So this setup works pretty well. So we are generating now these big simulations. And in the back, you actually see almost not, but a little bit, an output where Titan, the big supercomputer at Oak Ridge, actually told me down here it says the simulation went well. So this is one of them. Just to show you the stuff is running. How much time do I have? I want to talk a little bit about, so I told you that we are including neutrinos. And yesterday this question came up already, how do we simulate neutrinos in these simulations? And it's actually a difficult question, especially since the effect of the neutrinos is so small and we really want to get this accurately. So what do neutrinos do? So what I'm showing here, and I stole this plot from this review article from 2006. So what's shown here is actually the power spectrum with massive neutrinos divided by the power spectrum without any neutrinos. And so the neutrino mass is rising. And so you can see the suppression of the power spectrum when you put in massive neutrinos. And down here, the neutrinos behave like the cold dark matter. And the fluctuations grow like cold dark matter. And on small scales, as I said, the neutrinos lead to suppression of the power spectrum. What I'm showing you here is the linear power spectrum. So now the question is, what happens to the nonlinear power spectrum? So when we want to simulate neutrinos, in principle, what we have to do is we have to put in two species. So what you see here is this initial condition that I actually showed yesterday already for the dark matter. And then at the same redshift, the initial condition for the neutrinos. So what do you have to do? So one thing that you have to do is you put in a second species into your code. And the second thing is you have to be careful about the transfer function. So you take from CAM now something that tells you what the neutrinos are doing. And the growth function that we discussed is becoming now a little bit more complicated. So you saw in this morning again the growth function is a function of Z, but it becomes now for the neutrinos also a scale-dependent function. So it's a function of K, so it's more complicated. So the power spectrum doesn't just go up and down if I apply the growth function to it, but it actually changes the shape. And also what you have to do is you have to give the neutrinos a thermal velocity, and this makes them really, really fast. So as in this plot here, so if you look at the numbers, and you probably can't read them, so I read them for them, up here the fastest velocity of the particles was in the 6,000 kilometers per second range, so that's the dark matter. If you go down here and look at the neutrinos with their thermal velocity component, they go up much higher. They go up to a factor of five higher. So you are at 38,000 kilometers per second. And so numerically, this is a big challenge because if these things zoom through your simulation and you want to time step them, you have to be very, very careful. So this is a big problem. And the other big problem is that these guys are five times lighter as these times, and so this can lead to numerical scattering. So people have actually seen this and have tried to come up with different approaches to this. In 1993, Klippen actually et al. Did one of the first of these kind of simulations, and they just made the mass of the neutrino very high. At that point, we didn't have very good constraints, so he just put in something really heavy. Then another thing that you can do is you can just say, I evolved just the dark matter at the start, and at some point in my simulation, later on, so when the simulation is running, the particles slow down, right? So if you induce the neutrinos later on, they're not as fast anymore. And so this is what Gardini et al. Did in 1999. They just said, I start the neutrinos, I do the dark matter, as always, and then very late on in the simulation at Z of 10, I switch on the gravities for the neutrinos as well. Other people did something really adventurous. They started the simulation at Z of 4. So this is really dangerous because at that point you are already in the nonlinear regime, and but they wanted to do the two species, and I think this is very dangerous. Then you can see this group kind of realized what they did might not have been the best thing to do. So they changed their approach. So they actually put in one species and started it at 49, and then added the neutrino perturbations just in linear theory. So that's easy, right? Every time step you run CAM, you produce a linear power spectrum, you add that to the dark matter prediction and to go from there. In 2010, they decided to go back to two species. And actually, what they did then was they just made the neutrinos much more coarse-grained. Then there are other groups, and I don't have enough time to go through all of this. But what we did is we kind of followed this approach of not really caring too much about the nonlinear evolution of the neutrinos. And this is a lot of text now, but basically what we have done is we put the neutrinos into the background, we put the neutrinos into the initial condition, the same way as we have the baryons, so we assume that every dark matter, every particle in the simulation has a contribution from dark matter, from the neutrinos, and from the baryons. And then if you want the full power spectrum, you actually just add a linear piece from the neutrinos. So this is what several people have done. And the thing is that this will work fine if the neutrino is not too heavy. And the question was, how can we test this? And Amolu Patti, who was also a postdoc with us, very smart fellow, he looked into the time RG perturbation theory. So the one problem when you do neutrinos in higher order perturbation theory is this scale dependence of the growth function. So it gets, things get a little bit more complicated. And you have to be very careful about that. So Amol implemented all of this. And what you see here is actually a power spectrum divided by its non-Wiggle component. And the blue points are from our simulation where we use this approximation that I just discussed. And the red line is the result for from the time RG higher order perturbation theory. And the green line is if you take the time RG and you switch off this feedback of the neutrinos onto the dark matter, because that's basically what we are doing in the simulation when we only add in the linear component of the neutrinos at every time step. And so what you can see is that out here nothing agrees, and that's because perturbation theory breaks down. It's not because the simulation is wrong. So ignore this a little bit. But down here you see that this actually works pretty well. And this is for roughly a 1 eV neutrino. So this is actually already too heavy to be observationally relevant. And you see that this neglection of the feedback term is getting a little bit worse at higher redshift. And the reason for that is that we actually made sure that at Z of zero, our linear scales match in the simulation exactly what linear theory tells us. So this is a little bit by design. If you go to a lighter neutrino, so here we make the neutrino a factor of 10 lighter, you see that actually the difference between taking this back action into account or not, so the green and the red, if you could see that from the back, which you can't, but just trust me, green and red are basically on top of each other. So this back action doesn't do anything anymore. So basically what this tells you is that at least in the quasi-linear regime, this approach seems to do a pretty good job for light neutrinos. And the nice thing numerically is it's cheap. So I don't have to worry about my second species of particles. So this is basically what we have done. And just to kind of finish this up, so what we have done so far is, so the first 26 models are complete. We have the high-res runs, the low-res runs, RSD, Halo catalogs, everything is extracted. So we are working right now on putting together the emulators. The mass function is a little bit behind because the one thing that we want to provide is to give you a mass function where you can dial in the mass definition. So if you are an FOF, a friends of friends person, you can ask for that. If you're an overdensity person at different overdensities, you can ask for that. So that takes a little bit longer, but Sebastian Bouquet is joining our team and he just arrived at Argonne yesterday and he's going to help with that. Another 13 of these high resolution models have been completed already, so we are making really good progress. And one question is how can we share all the simulation data, because it's a lot and you can do a lot of science with this, with the community. And just as an advertisement, we are developing something that we call PDAX, which gives you an internet, well, a web-based connection to these simulations. So basically the idea is, so this is all under development. So you select the snapshot and the simulation model. You can even get some of our analysis tools, so you can have an emulator here, you can have a power spectrum routine, and all of this is running at NERSC, so it's running on the supercomputer. So you build up your workflow here, and so this is how you get access to the simulations. This, as I said, it's just an advertisement, but it's under development. And I think this might be a good way to make these simulations available to a bigger crowd. So lessons learned. As I said before, the idea of this whole project is almost 10 years ago, and the first emulator was released in 2009. The biggest worry we had at the start was really if we can get the simulation to the 1% accuracy level. And so on February 2nd, I had started already a whole bunch of simulations. I get this email from Martin White saying, sanity check. These emails from Martin, if you have ever worked with him, they always come late at night. And so then you have a sleepless night because you're thinking like, oh my God, did we screw this up or not? And so he says, I've been thinking about these runs some more and worrying about lots of different things. It's hard to know we are doing the things right at 1%. But in the end, we convinced ourselves it was all good. We did the first simple non-trivial example with providing the power spectrum emulator, and then we just extended this all. And as you can imagine, running and analyzing all these simulations, it's not easy, so we have actually people from the CS community who are helping me to put together automated workflows that this is actually easier to do. And then also we want to make this data publicly available, so this is another question. And so just to get you all into the sun and for lunch, this is a summary. So we need very high accuracy predictions. I think this will be a big worry with the upcoming surveys. And so the cosmic calibration framework is one way of how you can do that. The Coyote universe was the first example to show actually that you can do this with the matter and galaxy power spectrum. And there are many worries that you have. There are worries about the underlying accuracy of the underlying simulation, so you have to do careful testing. There are worries about the accuracy of the smoothing procedure and how to clean up all your simulations, the interpolation scheme. But overall, I think we were pretty happy with the results in the end. And so here I forgot Titan. So this is the Mira Titan universe. Will be really a nice set of simulations, and it spans 8 cosmological parameters. And so stay tuned. The results from that will come out soon. Thank you.
Questions?
So I remember that in the earlier simulations, events or phenomena like the bullet cluster were unlikely to appear. So what is the status? Is now difficult to obtain such phenomena like the bullet clusters or?
I didn't understand it. No, it's not. So lambda CDM. So what you are looking for is basically a merger of two big clusters, right? And no, I mean, they are not in contradiction with lambda CDM. It's a question of volume, and you can measure, if you have these big volume simulations, you have enough bullet clusters there.
I have a question about covariance matrix, because the dependence of cosmology parameters is also very important when you predict, and how at what point you have to also simulate the covariance matrix. And is that possible to build an emulator also for it?
Yes, so there's actually a paper out by, that was led by Michael Schneider, and he has built a toy emulator for the covariance matrix. The problem is that you really get into many more dimensions, and now you have to really simulate much more, right? So there are lots of questions. So one question you have to ask is, do I just need a large set of realizations of one cosmology, or do I actually have a cosmology dependence? So then it gets, again, very, very costly. Tim Eifler and Juliana Kwan are also, they looked into building an emulator just using the Halo model approach. And so, yes, so people are looking into it. It's hard because it just is a lot of simulations that you need, or a lot of predictions that you need, because you have yet one more. So you're right. I mean, everything that we did was just for the diagonal term and not the covariance. But yeah, it's something people are looking into, and emulators definitely can help you with that.
Any further questions?
I think there was a problem for warm dark matter simulations where some spurious subhalos appeared. And I think there are techniques that people use it to remove those. But how sensitive will be those interpolation schemes for the power spectrum at small scales to this spurious subhalos?
Right. So, gee, I wonder if you can see that on this graph. So the Wormdike matter is one of these. You know, when you do physics, you often do these projects where you say, "Oh yeah, I can do this really quickly," and then it turns out it's really complicated. So one of the problems with the Wormdike matter simulations are the scales. So what you can't really see well here, but what happens is that you have these halos forming here on these filaments in this what they call string of Pearl effects. And this is actually a numerical artifact. It depends on the resolution that you have. And people have tried to come up with solutions to that, like Tom Abel's group at Stanford. They are trying something new where they actually do a phase-based simulation to overcome this problem. So in the case of the neutrinos, this is actually not a problem because they're not that warm. So even though they're hot dark matter in some sense, but the mass is so small that you don't run into any of these problems. So for us, it's not an issue. But you're right, you have to be very, very careful when you do these simulations. And that's why while I implemented it and I use this plot all the time, we never continued this route because the numerics was just too iffy.
Any other question? When you're talking about changing in dark energy, does it contemplate only W0 and WA or other models of dark energy as well?
No, right now it's just W0, WA. I mean, there was a question like how would we parameterize something so that we can run a grid of things, but this seemed to be the most straightforward, so to speak. So yeah, it's just that.
Any other questions? Are there any comments? Well, we thank the speaker, Catherine.